Well, first, I would like to add my word of thanks to the leadership of United Arab Emirates, His Highness Sheikh Khalifa bin Zayed Al Nahyan, President of UAE, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, ruler of Dubai, and Vice President and Prime Minister of UAE, His Excellent Dr. Hanif Hassan Al Qasimi, UAE Minister of Education, and certainly want to add my thanks to the Knowledge Village family, the schools here representing Knowledge Village, the students who've worked so hard to pull together this event and to host us all. And I want to thank all of you for coming and engaging us tonight in this most important of conversations, especially those of you who are sitting on the floor and lining the walls. Thank you for your patience and your interest and being engaged with us tonight. Well, it is again a joy to be with Bassam and to be discussing these very important issues. One of the things I love about Bassam is committed to what he believes in, and that is always to be respected. And not only is he committed to what he believes in, but he's committed to representing it in a gracious way. And that, too, is always to be respected. And so to come to Dubai and to talk with Bassam is to come here and engage a friend, and I'm thankful for that. And coming to Dubai, for me, is a lot like, as I described to my host the other night, it's a lot like a college student coming home for break and finding his familiar room and resting well. And that's because of your warm hospitality and graciousness. So, our conversation for the night is, how can we find forgiveness from a holy God? You have heard Bassam give his answer from a Muslim perspective and also attempt to respond to a Christian perspective and attempt to respond to some of my own writings. I appreciate Bassam because he's wide read, from Thomas Aquinas to Thabiti Anyabwile. If we can, if we can get him out of the A's, he might be dangerous, you know. So. But nothing could be more important than we should discuss this question, and that we should discuss this question not dispassionately, but earnestly and with some urgency and feeling the personal import of this question. This is a question that affects us all. This is a question we must all find an answer to. So even though we're in Knowledge Village, this is not merely an academic discussion. It's profoundly personal. How do we find acceptance, forgiveness, cleanness with a holy God? Now, the question is simply stated, but I want to suggest to you that there are implicit in the question some assumptions that we ought to at least make explicit. And in making those assumptions explicit, use those as sort of the guiding frame for my comments tonight. So, five assumptions that are in this question that I would want to sort of pull out and lift up for your viewing tonight. Number one, the question assumes that forgiveness is necessary. Assumes that forgiveness is necessary. Number two, the question assumes that there is something wrong with us so that we need forgiveness. There's something wrong with each and every one of us, which makes forgiveness necessary. Number three, that thing that's wrong with us also has something to do with God. So we stand wrong and in need of forgiveness in relationship to God, in relationship to his specifically holy character. That's the fourth assumption, that God's holiness is incompatible with that thing that's wrong with us. If that's true, then number five, the question assumes that forgiveness is not automatic. It must, as the question frames it, be found. Whether that's us finding forgiveness, or as Bassam has represented a particular perspective, forgiveness finding us. Either way, it's not automatic. So let's take up these questions then. The first question we wish to ask and answer is, what is wrong with us? What's wrong with us? We don't like that question, do we? We'd rather think that we're okay. I'm okay, you're okay. Basically pretty good people having a discussion here. But in one word, the Bible's answer to that question is sin. Sin is what is wrong with all mankind. In one sense, the Bible, the entire Bible, is taken up with answering our question for tonight. The entire Bible is about this one issue, forgiveness, and finding forgiveness with God. and being reconciled with God. And so it begs the question, why is forgiveness necessary? Why are we looking for it? Well, again, the answer here is sin. Well, what is sin? The psalmist has given a definition tonight, saying that sin is particular acts of thought, thoughts and actions. Indeed, that's an element of sin. It's the outgrowth of sin. It's the fruit that hangs upon the tree. But the tree itself is not the actions or the thoughts. The tree itself is a nature. It's an inclination, not just action. So in Genesis chapter 2 and chapter 3, when God creates man and sets him in the garden and gives Adam and Eve, our first parents, a prohibition not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, sin enters the world when Adam and Eve desire the tree, take of it, and eat it in contradiction to God's command. Now, something happened there. Not only was an action taken, but a nature was corrupted. Here's where I think my friend Bassam misunderstands the Christian view of sin. We do not believe that God created man and is our first parents in sin. In fact, he created them good without sin. The entrance of sin is man's work. It's a corruption that we have brought into the world. And we believe that not only does everyone between Adam and ourselves commit acts of sin, but everyone since Adam has inherited that nature, has inherited that essence, that stain, that twisting of the soul, so that we desire not God and the things of God, but naturally we desire the gratification of our own desires. So there's a nature in us. It isn't just the actions. To use another theologian whose last name begins with A, Augustine, the city of God. He's reflecting on his own conversion, his own finding of forgiveness through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He had lived a profligate life as a young man. His mother, Monica, had prayed for him for years that he might be saved from God's judgment and be forgiven of his sins. And he talks about how in fact he had this nature, and he uses this illustration. He talked about one day stealing apples from a tree. How he saw the apples and wanted to take the apples. The apples didn't belong to him, and he did just what he desired. He went and he grabbed apples and he took the apples and he walked off having stolen the apples, and then this thought hit him. He didn't even like apples. He didn't eat apples. And so he puzzled. Why would I want to morally compromise myself to take something I don't even really want? The answer, sin, the nature, not just the actions. The actions are fruit that spring from a poison root. And that's our problem fundamentally with God. And Bassam was reading and quoting from my book, which I appreciate the sales, brother. Thank you very much. Rush out and get a copy. And he quoted the section in my book where I said, sin rests lightly on the Muslim conscience. Let me tell you what I mean there. I think Bassam's talk is an illustration of what I mean. I don't mean that Muslim people are unbothered by sin. I don't mean that they don't take sin seriously. I mean that there are, from a biblical perspective, some defects in the view of sin. And were those defects to be corrected, it would drive us to our knees in trembling panic before a holy God. So let me just tick off a few of those things here. I've already said, one, that sin is a nature, not just actions. It's not just what you think or what you do, but it is, as Jesus says in Mark's gospel in chapter 7, that all of those things that spring up, adulteries and lies and lust and so forth, they come not from outside a man, but they come from inside a man. They come from his heart. So that the problem we have is a problem we cannot escape. And the problem we have is not a problem solved by moral reform. I love a story of a friend's daughter who was being corrected by her mother and being trying taught to obey her mother. She was a strong-willed little girl, about 5 years old, and her mother had implemented some restrictions and explained that, you know, when you transgress this, then there's going to be punishments, and here are the punishments. And the little girl was good for a little while, and then one day, the little girl broke a rule that her mother had given her, and her mother came to her and said, well, now, you know, I've got to correct you now. She says, but first of all, do you know what you did wrong? The little girl said yes and cited her offense. She said, second of all, do you know that I was going to punish you for this? The little girl said, yes, I know you're going to punish me. What, do you remember what the punishment was? And the little girl said, yes, I remember what the punishment was. And the mother's a little bit flabbergasted, and she stands back and she looks at her little daughter and says, well, why did you do it? And the little girl said, I figured it was worth it. That's the sin nature. Looks at God's law and shrugs at breaking his commands because it figures that gratifying that nature is worth it. And that stain is in all of us. Till we understand that sin rests lightly on our conscience. A second point I'd say here is that Bassam made the argument that some sins are against God and some aren't. Beloved, every transgression, whether directly against God's character and name and law, or whether between man and man, is in effect a sin against God, who rules us not only in our individual relationship with him, but who sets rules for our relationship in all of society. So the one that we have to contend with because of our sin is God himself, not just each other. A third reason, the Bible says it is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a holy God. I wonder if you've noticed how Bassam used the word holy in his talk. He talked, for example, about the sort of holy triune nature of God when he was talking about concerns with the atonement or the holy attribute of justice. He seems to be using holy as an adjective for adjectives. The Bible's view of God's holiness is it is central to his character. To talk about the holiness of God is to talk about the godness of God. To talk about the holiness of God is to describe God as so absolutely pure that his purity is relentless in its persecution of impurity. To talk about the holiness of God is to talk about a being so perfected and so wonderful and so glorious in his perfections that sinful men cannot be in his presence and live. We don't understand our sin and understand ourselves until we see ourselves in light of this holy God. So when we speak of holiness, we're speaking about the nature of God, which is so opposed to the nature of man that we could not be in his presence and survive. Until we understand that sin rests lightly on our conscience. I need to make one more point about this. I think Bassam understands the extent of alienation then between God and man because of sin. If you've read your book, you've read the Bible, Genesis, you know that at the end of chapter 3, God banishes Adam and Eve from the garden and sets protection around the garden so that they cannot enter. Because again, they will be consumed in his holiness. It's a gracious thing that he has banished them. But that banishment is indicative now of an alienation, not just physical, but an alienation moral and spiritual. Yes, we are separated from God, and not only separated from God, but we are hostile toward God. We are enemies of God in our natural mind. Our thoughts are opposed to God. There is a warfare going on between the sinner and a holy God. Until we understand ourselves to have declared war against God and his sovereign right to rule, having usurped his authority and lived our own ways, until we understand that sin is resting lightly on our conscience. And if we meet God in that state, we will meet him as a warrior who in his holiness will put down every rebellion and every rebel. This is what I mean by sin resting lightly on our conscience. If we're not careful. Now, I should say there are some who would object and maybe say that they're not sinners. I'm not a sinner. Anybody want to raise their hand and say I'm not a sinner? Excellent. Because the Bible's answer is in Romans 3, verse 23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is another definition of sin right there. To be a sinner is to be something short of the glory, the perfection, the purity of God. That's all of us. David could say in Psalm 51, verse 5, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Well, even the tradition of Islam. Al-Bukhari, Hadith says this: I heard Allah's apostle saying, there is none born among the offspring of Adam, but Satan touches it. A child therefore cries loudly at the time of birth because of the touch of Satan, except Mary and her child. So even in Islam, you have a view of the fallenness of man from birth, the inheritance of sin. And our own personal experiences is the most plentiful data of the reality of the doctrine of sin, is it not? So consider, for example, the Lord's words in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, where he says, you have heard it said, thou shalt not commit murder. But I tell you that if you look on a man's, or if you have anger in your heart toward your brother, you've already committed murder in your heart. And similarly, he says, you've heard it said that thou shalt not commit adultery. But then he goes on to say, if you look at someone with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. And he goes on and says, now, do not swear. Why? Because we're so easily tempted to break our word and not keep our oath. And these are things that springs, Jesus tells us, from the heart of men, from the soul of men, from the root of men. And that's why we need forgiveness. That's what it is about us that necessitates forgiveness. Let me ask you another question. In our second question, we'll move much quicker. What does our wrong, our sin, have to do with God? Three things I'd like to suggest to you. Number one, it transgresses, as we've been saying, God's holy law. It is a rebellion against God. All of us have seen speed limit signs. They are speed limit signs, folks. I think I've seen some of you on Sheikh Zayed Highway. And there's no limit to the speed out there. Transgressing. Or you've seen signs perhaps in a neighbor's yard that says, keep off the grass. I don't know about you, but every time I see one of those, I go out of my way to transgress a little bit. No trespassing. God's law is like signs of that sort. Let's say, keep off, slow down, no trespassing. And we are transgressing him when we transgress his law. Secondly, what does this have to do with God? Well, it offends and dishonors God. We are made in God's image and created to spread his glory in the earth, but our sin corrupts and distorts his image, and rather than living for his glory, we live for our own. We're like children from a prominent family who go off to live in the world and dishonor and bring shame on their family. That's our relationship with God. We've dishonored him and brought shame upon him. The third thing, most terrible, what does this have to do with God? Our sin invites God's wrath. Wrath is a strong, holy anger and opposition against unrighteousness and injustice. And God's wrath results in our judgment if we die in our sins. Colossians 3, verses 5 to 6, Paul writes there, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, your sinful nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. And in Romans chapter 1, verse 18, we're told that wrath has already began to come. Because we're told there that the wrath of God is being revealed against from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. And Paul writes there three times in that chapter that if we're not careful, God will give us over to a depraved mind, to a sinful mind. And beloved, no man can withstand God's wrath. Romans chapter 2, verses 5 to 9. Let me read these for you. Because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath. Can you picture that? Storing up wrath, pouring it, as it were, into an endless vat to be poured back out against us on the day of judgment. You're storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath, when his righteous judgment will be revealed. God will give to each person according to what he has done. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. Day of wrath. This is what caused the psalmist to cry out in Psalm 130, verse 3, "If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, who could stand?" None of us can stand before God in our sins. Right now in parts of the world, there are leaders who are grasping on to power, and they are sending tanks and armed soldiers into the streets to maintain order and to suppress rebellion. If men respond with tanks and bullets, how do you think God will respond in his holiness to the rebellion of his creation who have opposed him and dare appear before him hostile in their sin? His wrath is infinite. Which brings us to our next question. Why is forgiveness necessary? It's an obvious question and an obvious answer. If we are guilty, shameful sinners who dishonor God, and if God is angry with us because of our sin, then forgiveness is necessary to escape God's holy wrath and judgment against sinners. Without forgiveness, there can be no acceptance with God. In fact, without forgiveness, we all receive God's death penalty, eternal death, by which Bassam rightly states, we mean eternal separation from the loving fellowship of God, an eternal conscious torment and judgment against sin. And that's been the case since Adam and Eve. God promised in Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, if they transgressed his law, that dying they would surely die. In Romans chapter 5, verse 12, we're told that death entered the world through Adam, and since we all participate in Adam's sin, death has entered us all. The death rate is 1-to-1. The burial of family and friends is the cumulative evidence of our rebellion and God's curse against us because of our sin. Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death. How many of you are college students? You're bright-eyed, you're bushy-tailed. You're working hard in your classes because you want to get out and get a good job And as a parent who will soon pay for college myself, I want that for my daughters too, so they graduate and they can live on their own dime and buy me dinner once in a while. And you want to get that good job so that you can provide for yourself and provide for your family. And that's a wonderful thing. And you'll go to work and hopefully you'll work hard for your employer. And what will you expect for your hard work and the skills that you bring to that job? You'll expect payment, won't you? Wages. Earnings. That's right and that's natural. Well, here the Bible tells us that the wages of our sin is death. It's as though God has called us to a job to obey him and to live for him and to subdue the earth and fill it with his glory. And we've gone into the office and rather than do the job he's called us to do and uniquely made us to do, well, we traded messages on Facebook. We played Angry Birds all day. Am I the only one that plays Angry Birds? And so rather than work for God and bring him honor, we have robbed God. So now the payment we get is not the blessed reward of a good day's labor. The payment we get is death. It's the retribution that God exacts for our stealing from the company. Am I robbing God of the honor and the glory that he's due? Can you see then that it's right for God to judge us for our sin? Our fourth question, on what basis then is forgiveness possible? Okay, so we admit we're sinners. We acknowledge that our sin makes us guilty before God and stirs up God's holy wrath against us. And we see that unless we find forgiveness, we cannot escape the wrath of God. So it prompts this question then. We're sinners, irreconcilable with a holy God who's angry with us for our sin. We have nothing that we can bring him to satisfy him. How then will we ever be forgiven? How will that chasm between God and man ever be gulfed? How will the rebel's hand ever be put in God's hand as a gesture of peace and friendship? On what basis will forgiveness be granted? Answer: forgiveness is only possible where God's wrath is satisfied for the past and future sins, and where a righteousness is provided that keeps God satisfied. There must be the turning away of God's wrath. The fancy word we use for that is propitiation, the satisfaction of his wrath. And simultaneously, there must be a perfect righteousness that covers us and keeps us until we're brought home to glory safely. The fancy word we use for that is justification. If God's anger over past sin is satisfied, but we're still left with a sinful nature, and we're still left on our own to try and keep God satisfied, what will happen? We will again sin and anger a holy God. This is why we can never fall back on our own actions. This is why our deeds can never be offered to God as something that pleases God. The prophet Isaiah says, our righteousness are as filthy rags before God. There's enough sin in your righteousness and my righteousness to condemn us forever. We need both a satisfaction of God's wrath and a perfect righteousness that keeps him pleased. Well, how do we get that? How is that possible? Before I answer that, let me ask you to think about your own lives. Have you ever prayed something like this? Dear God, if you forgive me this sin, then I will never do it again. Or if you ever prayed something like this, Lord, if you get me out of this trouble, then I'll be a better person or a better Muslim, I promise. Some of you lie, so I take it to mean you've prayed like that before. Now, what happened after you prayed that prayer? Wasn't long, was it, before you either committed the same sin or discovered you had a bevy of other sins that were present in your life? Our own experience tells us it doesn't work. We can't depend upon our own righteousness. If that's true, then we should admit that the satisfaction and the righteousness that we need to offer God, they don't come from us. They have to come from somewhere else. That the things that turn away God's wrath and the things that present to him a perfect obedience, they're not going to come from us. They have to be alien to us. I have a good friend who says that we think that our problems are out there and our solutions are in here. But what the Bible tells us is the problem is in here and the solution is out there. Namely, the solution is Christ, Jesus, the Son of God, God the Son, who gave himself as a substitute for us, to bear the Father's wrath, satisfying it completely, turning away the anger of the Father, and who at the same time, because of his sinless obedience and sinless perfection, offers on our behalf a perfect righteousness that always pleases the Father. It's the cross. It's what Jesus has done on the cross that brings sinners hand in hand with the holy God, because Christ has turned away his anger. And Christ has offered an obedience that is pleasing to him. It runs through the whole Bible. The theme of sacrifice runs through the entire scripture. It all in the Old Testament, the sacrifice of bulls and goats, is pointing forward to a perfect sacrifice, namely the sacrifice of the Son of God. Those sacrifices of the Old Testament, they offered daily and yearly, and the high priest made sacrifices for himself, then for the people. But Jesus, who had no need to offer sacrifice for himself, offered himself as a ransom for his people. Not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with the perfect blood of the Son of God. A blood that satisfies the righteous requirements of God and the wrath of God. So we read in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14, by one sacrifice, that's propitiation, he has made perfect forever, that's perfect righteousness, those who are being made perfect. Or Hebrews 10:10, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. The cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, the sinless Son of God, is the only basis upon which forgiveness can be granted to sinners. Let me say that again. The cross of the Lord Jesus Christ and our trusting in his sacrifice on our behalf and believing in him and relying upon his promise to bring us eternal life and to forgive us of our sins. His cross is the only basis for the forgiveness of sinners. Because it's in his cross and his cross alone where the righteous requirements of God and the wrath of God are satisfied and where mercy also may be shown without contradiction. This is the Bible's claim. So Romans chapter 3, verses 21 to 26. Would you listen closely? I'm almost done. Now a righteousness from God, it's an important phrase. It's a righteousness from God, not ourselves. Now, a righteousness from God, apart from law, apart from anything that we do, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God, listen, comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Listen, God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement. And you know what atonement means? It means at-one-ment. Christ has made us at one with God. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this. He presented Jesus as a sacrifice of atonement. He did this to demonstrate his justice. Contrary to Basham's claim, it is the act of God giving his son in the place of sinners that demonstrates his justice. He did this to demonstrate his justice because in his forbearance, in his patience, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time so as to be just, that is righteous, and the one who justifies, that is, declares righteous, those who have faith in Jesus. This righteousness with God, this forgiveness with God, with a holy God, comes through faith in Jesus Christ. And it is Jesus' sacrifice upon the cross and that alone which is sufficient basis for our forgiveness. Apart from the cross and faith in Christ, you are in your sins. And the wrath of God abides upon you. Beloved, flee the wrath of God. Flee the judgment to come. Find shelter in the cross of Christ, where God himself vindicates his own name by punishing sin and shows mercy to the sinner through faith in his Son. How do you respond to this message? How do we gain forgiveness? There's only one way. This one way is enough. Repent of your sins. Turn from your own nature. Turn from your own sinful actions. And trust in Jesus Christ. Believe upon him. Rely upon him. Follow him as your Lord and your God, as the one who has offered himself for your forgiveness. Repent and believe, and you will be saved. Thank you very much.